es el día de dar. Y también antes de la conversación que va a tener Gonzalo Fanjul con esa Curran que está en Nueva York y que ahora van a empezar, os animo a todos los que estáis conectados ahora a que tuiteéis, a que utilicéis las redes para lanzar los mensajes que están saliendo aquí en nuestro demos. No dejéis de hacerlo. En todas las redes, en Twitter, en Facebook, mandar mensajes de lo que está ocurriendo hoy aquí en la Casa del Lector en el Demos 2020. Bueno, muchas gracias y ya sin más dilación le paso la palabra a Gonzalo Fanjul. Que Gonzalo, una vez más, muchas gracias por estar en nuestro Demos. Esta es tu casa.
Muchas gracias.
Te sientes ahí muy solo, pero no estás solo, estás muy acompañado porque aquí hay mucha gente que te está escuchando, lo mismo que a Asa Curran, que está allí en Nueva York y nos está escuchando y ya, bueno, ya la tenemos en pantalla. Adelante.
Muy bien, pues muchísimas gracias. Asa, good afternoon, good morning to you in New York, and thank you so much for joining us this afternoon in this conversation. I hope that you can hear me properly. Is that
I can.
Yes? Okay.
Yes.
Excellent. So, Asa Curran, for those of you that are not familiarized with her name, which now is, I think, that's globally renowned, is the founder of Giving Tuesday. Giving Tuesday is an initiative that in 8 years has already extended to 70 countries. I think that it is changing the way we understand philanthropy, we understand the contribution of individuals and organizations to the common goods and to the public interest. An initiative that goes far beyond raising funds, although raising funds is a critical part of it. It has to do with sharing data for the common good. It has to do with collaborative models. It has to do with identifying and scaling up best practices. And Asa Curran is a unique speaker in this regard. Among many other things, she now serves as the chair of the board of directors of Guardian.org and was named to the Nonprofit Times Top 50 Power and Influence list in 2019 and 2020. So thank you again, Asa, for joining us this afternoon. And we have a little bit more than 40 minutes for this conversation. And let me start with a question that many people may be asking, particularly when we consider the phenomenon of Giving Tuesday out of the United States. No, this idea of Black Friday and then Cyber Monday and things that we are already familiarized with, but are pretty uncommon in our. And some people might see Giving Tuesday as like another consumption exercise after the other two, no? Like washing our conscience on Tuesday after having spent. And I know that this is much more than that. How would you describe the exercise of Giving Tuesday? How would you describe the moment that you thought that this was something worth creating and worth extending?
I think it's such an excellent question with several different parts. It wasn't my idea. It was the idea of a person who was then my boss, Henry Timms. He now is the CEO of Lincoln Center, which is a very large performing arts organization here. And the two of us built it together, but with the community and advice of many, many, many other people. And that's a really important part of how it became what it is, that we really looked outside of our own organization and to friends in technology, to friends in academia, to friends in media, and to say, you know, what do you think of this idea and what should we be careful of and what should we try? And we were very risk tolerant and very willing to experiment. And, you know, it just blew up out of all of our possible expectations. I think it's really important to me that Giving Tuesday not be seen as just another transactional day. I think of Giving Tuesday as quite transformational in the way that it views generosity and in the way that people and organizations use it as a platform and a megaphone for generosity, for community, for shared humanity. And, you know, fundraising is important, and donations to NGOs are important, but it's like a kiss is important, but it's not the only expression of love, right? It's one, and there are many, many others, probably too many to count. And I feel the same way about generosity, that that it is not only able to be manifested in countless ways, but that those ways build on one another, right? That that an act of generosity generally leads to a greater act of generosity because it's so rewarding. And ultimately, that really has the power to transform behavior. And transforming behavior has the power to transform entire societies. Because it all every decision we make begins with the values that we are driven by. So I think Giving Tuesday is the only existing movement that is based entirely around one value. And the fact that it is a value that is shared by all cultures, all religions, all people, all languages, just gives it this beautiful feeling of universality that is not about a transaction.
Right. Can you, is there an example, a case that you are particularly attached to that from your experience that shows that transformative power of Giving Tuesday? I mean, I'm thinking about the reality of many nonprofits and NGOs around the world that for which fundraising is already a nightmare and is one of the and the fact that you are offering them not just a vehicle to increase their income but something that goes far beyond that. Can you provide us an example of an organization that for you is can illustrate this argument?
I can tell you about some of the things that have happened that I find the most meaningful. But I would first say that the thing that's most meaningful to me about it is not any one story. It's all of them happening together, right? It's all of this generosity, these small acts of generosity or small creative campaigns from organizations. It's all of them happening together that is the really amazing thing. So I think some, you know, things that I love that people tend to do tend to be really creative. So really trying something new, whether that's an organization or just an individual, right? We have one woman who sets up little free pantries in her community, right? Little sort of stands where extra food can be put, where people can take it, you know, as needed. You know, just lots of exercises in trust and generosity in that way, caring for one's community, caring for one's neighbors, and not only immediate family. On an organizational level, I tend to really enjoy campaigns and ideas that are collaborative. So I think that one problem that plagues the nonprofit sector, and I would venture to say that this is a problem everywhere that I've traveled, is lack of collaboration. That organizations are really trained to view each other as competitive rather than as potential partners. That we really see generosity as being very finite, right? Like a pie, and we're all running to get our little piece of it and hope that nobody else takes a bigger piece of it than we get. And that's a really toxic mindset, right? What we call a scarcity mindset. And instead, with Giving Tuesday, we try to say that that generosity is totally infinite. There is literally no bottom to the well of generosity. And if you look at it that way, then you think first about your mission, right? Less about your fundraising, less about your brand, right? And think about the things that you're, what you exist to do in the world, the problem that you exist to solve. And then you realize that it's much more likely that you'll solve that problem if you work together with others to solve it, not if you work in your own little silo. That's and working right. with others is more rewarding. It's generally more interesting and creative because everybody's bringing their best ideas and their skills and their, you know, unique identities to the table to create something that hasn't existed yet. And it flexes all kinds of new organizational muscles so that after the collaboration, the organizations emerge stronger, more creative, more innovative, and more willing to take on those kind of collaborations and take on risks. Now, one thing I would say this year during the pandemic that I'm seeing that I really love is that many organizations can't do what they do in the same way, right? For various reasons. And so instead of just sitting back, they're pivoting to try to do what they do in new ways. So one example that I love is an organization, it's here in the States in California, which is a jazz company, a musical organization, performing arts organization that gives concerts, right? And they can't because people aren't allowed to gather indoors, and so they can't do their usual thing, and they're losing lots and lots of money because they can't sell tickets, and still they want to perform and they want to make music, and the musicians want to play. And so what they're doing is playing open air concerts for people who are waiting for 6-7 hours online at local food banks,
right,
to get their food. And for me, the reason that that is such a beautiful example of generosity is that it acknowledges that we don't just need a can of soup to survive, right? That we actually deserve more than that, that we can bring not just basic alleviation of suffering into the lives of others, but also, you know, beauty and music and healing. And that is as important as anything else to our mental health right now. Giving Tuesday has always been about, fundamentally about human connection. And so organizations that really prioritize that sense of connection and shared humanity are also, you know, just wonderful. There's one example I read just today from our Croatia leader about our local artist who's leaving wrapped packages of artwork around the community just for people to find and, you know, accept as an anonymous gift. So that kind of thing is just amazing. And it has nothing to do with fundraising, right? That I don't know that there's an organization behind it that will make any money. At the same time, that's not to say that fundraising is not important, and especially important right now. But I think that when you engage people with a full acknowledgement of their generosity and their place in the world and their desire to make a difference, you're actually going to make more money than if you simply ask for money, as if the person has no more capacity in this world than to hand over some money and that's it. And that's not what people want, right? Henry wrote a book several years after we started Giving Tuesday called New Power, where he talks about in this current age that we're in, how people really want to be radically participatory. They don't just want to hand over a check or click a donate button. They really want to feel the totality and holisticness of their impact, and to really be involved and to have their voices heard. And so I'm not sure that we're acknowledging those dynamics as much as we could. And the organizations that tend to do the best do acknowledge that those dynamics and open the space for real participation from people who want to be generous by offering them multiple ways to engage and being very responsive with them.
Asha, the way you are describing this, what I find fascinating is that somehow you are describing a vaccine against the pandemic of polarization that we are suffering right now. You are describing a true common ground and a space where people that think very differently can get together in that regard. And I can't imagine how important that is in your context right now, in our context right now, in everybody's context, in an age of polarization where it is so difficult to find those common grounds. Maybe Giving Tuesday is providing that to a certain extent.
I think it is. And again, that's another reason that I think it just can't be compared to something like Black Friday or Cyber Monday, right? I don't think that those days exist to do what they do, and they do what they do very well. But I don't think that they provide that same sense of community, of connection, of shared humanity. And I love your analogy to the vaccine. I do think that's what it is. You know, I think that one of the ways that people actually cope with anxiety, loneliness, isolation, all the things that we're feeling right now is through generosity. It's right. Not something that they forget about because they're so worried about everything else. It's something that they actually use to make themselves feel better. It makes you feel better to give. It makes you feel better to make an impact in someone else's life or in the health of your community or in the health of the world beyond your community, and knowing that you're making a difference to complete strangers. So I do think it's a powerful force, and one that I really hope we don't let go after today. I don't think we are. I think that we've seen incredible levels of generosity during the pandemic. But I think what's special about Giving Tuesday is that sense of collectivism, right? I know that no matter how small, whatever it is I have to give, right? If it's a small donation, if it's a painting that I'm leaving on a park bench, if it's a can of food for a neighbor, if it's a talent or a skill, if it's a thank you note to, you know, first responders, whatever it might be, I'm doing that small thing. And so are hundreds of thousands, probably millions of other people. Probably millions of people just here in the US and many, many more millions more around the world. And that sense of that's a larger sense of community, right? I can feel connected to my very local community, but then I can feel this sense of connection with the broader human community. And I, that's the part I hope that we keep alive after this day.
Do you think that COVID is going to enhance that? Is going to take us to the right direction, or is going to make things more complicated? Because we've seen the best and the worst of our societies. We are about now to engage in a global response, for instance, in terms of the vaccine, that on the one side reflects the capacity of the international community to produce a vaccine in 1 year as opposed to the decade or decade plus that we used to see. And at the same time, we see rich countries like the US, like the European Union and others getting as many vaccines for themselves as possible while ignoring the harsh reality of many developing countries. So we see the best and the worst. And I wonder, where do you think this is taking us? To what extent do you think COVID is a lesson that is here to stay? Or do you think that we will just pass it and come back to the status quo after this?
I pray that we don't go back to the status quo. And I think that's the big question, right? The level of generosity right now is very intense. And, you know, there's a phrase that I use often, which is radical generosity. And the definition of radical generosity, at least my definition of it, is true solidarity, not thinking of generosity as a dividing line between rich people or poor people or people who have something and people who have nothing, but an acknowledgement that we all lack something. We all have something, right? And so there is a sense of solidarity in that that I think people are feeling very strongly right now because of the universality of the COVID experience, because we feel like we are sharing this sense of anxiety and fear with the whole world in the same way that today we're sharing this sense of optimism and generosity Absolutely. With the whole world, right? It works both ways. Now, the question is, we are seeing all of these inequities, right, laid bare, certainly in the United States and in other places as well. You know, are we going to go back to that way of living? Or are we going to rebuild what has been broken in a much better way than it was broken in the first place? And I don't think you have to be political to ask yourself the question, if a society is based on the foundational value of generosity, which is that of solidarity, which is that of the suffering of someone else is as intolerable to me as the suffering of my own child. Right. If we were really to base the rebuilding on that concept, how different would it all look? And can we do that? Can we do that even halfway would lead to a radically different world. And I have to believe that that's possible. It might be a longer journey than I would like, but I think that sometimes a crisis like this can be a forcing mechanism, can force people's eyes open, force people to acknowledge the things that maybe they didn't want to see before, because people are falling through the cracks, yes, more because of COVID, more right in front of our eyes, but they were before too. They were before. And that generosity was lacking in that as well. And I think there's also a tendency to view generosity as being so closely tied to money that we lose sight of how important non-monetary forms of generosity are to a healthy and thriving society. So something that bothers me personally is when I hear the US referred to as the most generous country solely because we have the highest levels of donations. That does not make us the most generous country. right? What makes a country generous is the way that its citizens treat each other, the way that a country's government treats its citizens, right? The safety that everyone can feel in their own shelter and that being fed and being taken care of. And that kind of generosity is often not present in this country.
Right.
So I think, you know, I've spent the last few years traveling so extensively, I can't even describe it, because I find it so fascinating to learn about what generosity looks like in all of our different Giving Tuesday countries.
Right.
And it has really just been so eye-opening to learn about just the basic cultural traditions that are generosity-based, but so ingrained that the people who are doing them might not even call it that, right? That, you know, when there's traditions that ensure that someone can always make it through a crisis, pay their rent, right? Be taken care of when they have a new baby, you know, not eat meals alone, right? There's like, we lack a lot of those here. And to me, those are, you know, those make social fabric strong in the same way that a strong civil society
Absolutely.
Helps with that. And so I think all of those forms have to be paid attention to. And we all, I think, have to take a much more global view of generosity because we have so much to learn from each other. I can only imagine the utopia of a post-COVID world mm-hmm. where all of the best generosity traditions that I've seen from around the world all somehow weave together and begin to be integrated and adopted by others.
Absolutely. Let me take this as a cue for a question to learn a little bit more about the model of Giving Tuesday. Okay, for those that are listening to us that maybe are not so familiarized, you have just mentioned that traveling, you can see the different cultures of donation, the different cultures of generosity. And I read this fantastic article by you in the Stanford Social Innovation Review, where you explain how the model is adaptive. And you explain a series of characteristics of the model of Giving Tuesday. And I would like you to expand a little bit more on that, and maybe to tell us a little bit about how you are using techniques. In your bio, you insist a lot on the use of data, for instance, as one of the elements that is important for you. I wonder if other new techniques, such as behavioral sciences and the understanding of the audiences that you are dealing with, is part of that. Can you tell us a little bit more about the model and how does it adapt to the different contexts where you establish it?
Sure. As far as I can tell, it is a totally unique model of organization / initiative / movement. We call it, or have begun to call it, a nucleus model. And the way that it works is that, so we have a small nonprofit. What I'm actually CEO of is a nonprofit with 25 staff members.
Right.
Globally distributed. We're all around the world, and we're a virtual team. And we exist to support and facilitate and connect and amplify the work of the hundreds of people around the world who are leading Giving Tuesday movements in their own countries. So that's more than 70 countries at this point, mm-hmm. in communities. So small towns, big cities, all around the world have their own locally based Giving Tuesday movements. Mm-hmm. So we have their leaders as part of our community and the leaders of all of the countries as part of our community. But the thing about the model that is so special is that not just that they all exist, but how interconnected they are. They are truly interconnected, interdependent, and they are so mutually supportive. So the principles that guide the interactions between those leaders are openness and transparency and mutual support and the sense that a success is only really a success once it has been replicated by others. And the potential of that is radical. If you can imagine a good idea, you know, happening in Taiwan and then being replicated within weeks, within days sometimes, in Tanzania and Brazil and Estonia and Chile, right? Then you have something that has not existed in the social sector before, which is this incredible community of practice or community of trust. that is very, each country leader and each community leader is free to adapt Giving Tuesday in any way they want. And that's what also makes it different than, say, a franchise, right? Where we might have people set up Giving Tuesday chapters, but they have to use our rule book. They have to do all the things we say. They have to use our logo and our style guidelines. And it's not like that at all. We want Giving Tuesday in each country to feel like that country, to reflect that country's needs and goals and identity and people. And so they each look utterly unique, but at the same time, they do share and are unified by an overarching vision of a more generous world. And it's that part, that shared vision, that makes it a movement and not just a model. So the in the very beginning, our direct relationships tended to be with nonprofits, right? Maybe a couple hundred nonprofits in the United States were using Giving Tuesday and we would work directly with them. And now, of course, we can't do that at all because there's just millions and millions of them. And so it is this community of leaders that has emerged as the broader movement leadership. And they're just absolutely inspiring. And some of them are, Giving Tuesday in Spain has been one of our longest standing movements and strongest and most multi-sector, most creative. And so some of our countries, like yours, have been with us for 7-8 years, and some are brand new this year. And so it also keeps becoming very rejuvenated, and certain countries are stronger in some areas, right? In corporate relationships or in engaging children, engaging schools and families. And some are better at very grassroots initiatives or working with young people. And so they all bring that together and make each other better. So it's a really remarkable model, and certainly does involve some letting go and some risk, right? Right. People ask me all the time, what if one of those leaders does something terrible? But, they haven't so far. And I think that the community is so strong that it simply wouldn't tolerate that kind of bad behavior. I don't think it's anything that I would need, a lawyer to try to handle. So it's just a very different way of thinking about meeting a mission. And it's funny, when people ask how big my team is, I don't know whether to say 25 or 500, because it really could be either. Okay. And then there was a second part to your question that I totally lost track of.
Okay. You are still there. Sorry. Let me ask you a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about the your vision about the future of philanthropy and how... How you think? I mean, you are in a unique place to understand what has been the evolution of philanthropy in the last years. It is true that in a very short time we are seeing at the global level an effort of creativity and innovation, particularly at the private-public collaboration level, and a role of philanthropic organizations that, is even getting very polemic, no? We are seeing how, I'm thinking about the Open Society Foundations and the role that they play in certain sectors, the way that they are attacked for that, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in the global health sector and the way, and many others that are really establishing the path in this regard, from the biggest to the smaller, no? So where do you see the future of philanthropy? Do you think that large organizations are still going to be critical? What importance do you attach to the role of individual donors, particularly organized individual donors? And this is something that I understand, that when you talk about Giving Tuesday in relation in the context of Me Too and Black Lives Matter, you talk about a movement, you talk about something that goes beyond the mere addition of individuals. How important that is, and where do you see this is going?
I think that a few different things. I think that right now philanthropy is undergoing a major reckoning. There has been a lot of discussion about inequities of power that exist within the philanthropic world that everyone knows will have to be dealt with. And so I think we're going to see some major shifts in that regard. At the same time, we're seeing shifts in power in the way that big institutional philanthropy is meeting movements like Giving Tuesday, which are entirely about the grassroots power of those without big institutional influence or lots of capital, and being faced with how powerful they actually are. Even without that traditional power and capital, they are powerful, they are impactful. So I think institutions aren't going anywhere and movements aren't going anywhere. And the question that will be in front of us to reckon with is, how do we meet the two? How do we make the two work in harmony rather than in conflict? And it's not about one being better or one being worse. I honestly think we need both, but I think that institutions have to make room for the sense of grassroots agency and the wisdom of people in their communities to know what those communities need, and to be comfortable with the loss of control that comes with funding and supporting non-traditional things like Giving Tuesday, right? Because they're not traditional things to fund, and yet they need to be supported. They are Giving Tuesday is a public good. It has to be supported because we will never take money right. from the people who actually engage with Giving Tuesday or the organizations who use Giving Tuesday as a platform. Right. So I think those conversations really need to happen, and in both movement wisdom and institutional wisdom are important and are valuable. And can we begin to share that wisdom in a way that moves us all forward in a better way, rather than having this constant conversation about, well, movements are the only way that things are going to get done in the future, or that they're just a riot. They're just lots of jumbled voices, right. not making any sense, not with right. any real leadership, and it has to be the traditional way, the power structures that we have understood for a long time. I don't think either one of those things is true,
right.
but I do think there has to be some middle ground, and I do think there's also an important conversation about the philanthropic world being very much, you know, kind of guided by wealthy, white, Anglo-Western, male, kind of prototypical mm-hmm. Leadership. And that's not the profile of the communities that are usually being served. And what that does is to take away the voices of those communities and to put, you know, the who knows best, right? Is it those institutional leaders? Is it the communities?
Absolutely.
You know, so far it's been very much on one side of the equation. And I do right. really, really hope to see that change, because one thing I've learned through working with Giving Tuesday is that those leaders in each of the countries, in each of the communities, know absolutely better than any big institution
absolutely.
What is going to make those communities thrive.
What is the importance that you attach to the youngest people on this? And when I mean the youngest, not the 20s, not the people in the 20s, but the people that are now starting to get engaged in. I have a daughter of 19, a daughter of 16. They are active feminists, engaged in a way that I wasn't. I can say I've always been in these things, but I feel an energy in this generation that is different, that has a capacity, a potential to change that is extraordinary. To what extent Giving Tuesday is trying to connect with that section of the population?
Well, first of all, I'll say we have children almost exactly the same age. I have a 19-year-old daughter and a 15-year-old. Yeah. And I see exactly the same thing. I every time I hear somebody say they're so worried about this generation, I see something different every single day. I'm worried about them too. I think they face big challenges, right. big challenges. But I think that as human beings, they are so deeply engaged in issues of social justice. They also have yes. been raised in an environment, and I don't mean by me and you, probably by me and you, but I mean
absolutely.
Just in the environment of social media yes. and so forth, where they just expect to have their voices heard. I doubt that you and I at age 16 expected our voices to be heard. Such an idea would never have even occurred to me. And so we have a whole youth program called Giving Tuesday Spark, And it is entirely child-led, by which I mean we don't tell these kids what to believe in. We don't tell them how to do their job. We don't tell them what platforms to use. We just support them because they are so savvy and they believe in what they're doing so strongly. And we've been just hearing a bunch of them just today. The things they're doing are so remarkable. Everything from, you know, putting together hundreds of food kits, you know, to give away to people at shelters or in the streets, to one boy who was making sure to call all of his elderly relatives to have conversations with them today because he knew that that would make them happy. So I think kids are giving me a lot of hope at the moment.
Really
inspiring.
Asha, sorry, they are telling me we have 3 minutes, you said? Ah, sorry, because I was confused with it. Well, I must apologize publicly and in particular to Asha because I sent her in advance a series of questions for this conversation and I have not followed at all the because I was much more interested in following the conversation that you were steering because I find it absolutely fascinating. Let us use this couple of minutes that we have left for a message from you to the Spanish philanthropic community, stakeholders, the audience we are talking to. Spain is a tough country in that regard. We do not have a culture of philanthropy. We are building it with a lot of pain. But I think that Demos, this space, is a fantastic opportunity in this regard for you to send maybe a brief message from the Giving Tuesday movement to our context.
Yes, sure. I'm so sorry I can't be there in person. I've visited several times and I love it there so much. I would say that we are just really encouraging organizations not to step back at this time. I think there's a temptation for organizations to think the need is so great, everybody's being asked, nobody has any money, but actually you're doing someone a favor by asking them to be generous, you know, and people want to be generous. We talked right in the very beginning about it makes people feel better to be generous. So give them that opportunity. Don't retreat. Don't step back. Make a case for how urgent it is right now. Be authentic about the challenges that you're facing. And I think most importantly, give people many ways to engage with your work. Remember, people are not just, you know, wallets with bodies attached. Absolutely. They are, you know, entire souls that are driven by the value of generosity and make that engagement feel as meaningful as it possibly can to them. And know that everybody is sensing that we will only be able to get through this together. And generosity is the connective tissue.
Thank you so much, Asha. I hope that you can hear the virtual applause. It was a fascinating conversation. Thank you for your time and your generosity. The best of luck for the Giving Tuesday movement. And I recommend everybody to stay online. Now we have a conversation between Isabel Legallo and Miranda Massi, the director of the Climate Change Museum in New York. And I'm sure that you will continue fascinated as we were with Asha Curran conversation. Thank you so much, Asha.
Thank you for having me. It was
really muchas gracias. Muchas gracias, Asha. Muchas gracias, Gonzalo. Pido a todo el público de aquí y a los que nos siguen virtualmente un aplauso para Asha. Te queremos, Asha. Te queremos, Gonzalo. No está Asha con nosotros, pero nos faltaba lo del libro, el tema del libro. Pero veo que ya no está Asha con nosotros, o sí. Bueno, muchísimas gracias, Gonzalo, por formar parte una vez más de nuestro Demos 2020. Y gracias por estar aquí. Y adelante, continuamos con la sesión. Ya lo ha explicado Gonzalo, en 10 minutos continuamos con la siguiente sesión, que va a ser con Isabel Legallo, la directora de la Fundación Daniela y Nina Carasso, una conversación con Miranda Massi, que es la directora del Cambio Climático de Nueva York. Será otra conexión con Nueva York, pero en 10 minutos estamos ahí. Así que os damos 10 minutos y a las 5 comenzamos de nuevo.